having completed all of that tedious genetic work where we're looking at small-scale microevolutionary processes and doing all that bean counting, we're now ready to take a step back. And the first topic I want to discuss is speciation. We're now ready to look at processes of large-scale evolution. First one will be the process of speciation. We will also, in future lectures, look at patterns in macroevolution. So, what about species? What are they? What do they do? Let's again start with a bit of history. Let's go back to the time of the Greeks, where Plato had this view of there being an ideal form. And so there's always a sparrow. It may be replaced by lower life forms that sort of made their way up the great chain of being, but the sparrow was a sparrow was a sparrow. Okay? And Linnaeus thought all of creation was a result of divine intervention over a very short period of time. So therefore, again, species were fixed. They're immutable. They couldn't change. But when Darwin finally published his big, big book about evolution, he didn't call it evolution. He called it The Origin of Species, because the sheer fact that new species could appear was completely contradictory to the way the world was viewed up to that point. The Origin of Species is really addressing itself about processes that ultimately would lead to speciation. So one of our organizing questions here today is to contrast different taxonomic groups. And we've seen that there's phenomenal numbers of insects, and especially of the beetles. So why is it that some evolutionary lineages are so species rich? Why there are literally hundreds of thousands of different species? Beetles comprise nearly a third of all animal species. On the other hand, we have things like this, the coelacanth. It's a living fossil. It's been around for hundreds of millions of years, essentially unchanged. And today, there's only two species of coelacanth. So why is it that while some species form new kinds of species all the time, others persist with so few descendants? And, well, we're talking about species. What is that? What is a species? There have been, over the last century, lots of very precise definitions of a species. And I don't want you to know any one of these in any detail, except for the biological species concept. That's the one we're going to be talking about in class. But just do be aware that this has been a puzzle to biologists for a long period of time, and there have been all kinds of fancy names and fancy ideas about what a species might actually represent. And in talking about the biological species concept, we're going to be very precise in our definition. A species in the biological species concept is defined as a population or set of populations that can only interbreed with each other. Now, what this looks like is this. We have each dot here representing an individual, and there are clusters of these individuals, and some of these are green, some are over here, some are over here. And if we were to look at them and keep track of who they mated with, who their offspring were, we'd see that they mostly are in interaction with each other within the same population. Whereas these over here, again, all these green dots, they're in frequent communication with each other. And then if we were to watch through time, we might see gene flow, occasional dispersing animal or plant going from one population to the next, be exchanged back and forth. And there might be exchanges over here, but not between them, okay? So this is what we call a species. The biological species concept, you have all these individuals that only interact and only mate with each other and not anybody else. And this is another perfectly good species. So for this to be true, there has to be separation. There cannot be an exchange, frequent exchange of genetic material between these different species. Otherwise, they would become genetically too similar, and we'd want to be thinking of it as just one big population. So biological species must remain genetically isolated from each other. Otherwise, gene flow would blur the distinctions between populations. So what we wanted to look at now are the barriers. We want to ask, what are the barriers to successful interbreeding? What prevents members of two different species from producing fertile offspring?